This is my first really awkward video, but this topic is really important. I was inspired by someone named Leanne on Instagram today who shared her experience with birth trauma. Birth Trauma Support Family shared her YouTube video and they're featuring it right now. So check out Birth Trauma Support Family. I think it's important for other people to hear other people's experiences and to know that they're not alone. I felt so alone and isolated with what I went through. I just didn't know that other people felt the same. My story starts when I was 17 years old. I took 3 tests. All of them were positive. I knew I didn't want medicine, and I think that that's as much as I knew about birth, was that some people take medicine, some people don't. So I was young and really uneducated about birth. All I knew was that I was super afraid to give birth. I think the biggest thing that I was afraid of with birth was just the unknown. The first red flag should have been whenever he started commenting on my weight after I told him, you know, I think I struggle with anorexia and it's really hard for me to eat 3 meals a day because I haven't for so long. So my weight became like the conversation topic at every appointment. I started to gain weight really rapidly whenever I started to eat 3 meals a day. So him knowing that I had anorexic tendencies and him knowing that eating 3 meals a day was a struggle in the beginning, he still commented on my weight because I was 98 pounds whenever I found out that I was pregnant. And so I began to eat. After eating 3 meals a day, I did start to gain weight. It was rapid. And I think what had happened was that I had gone so long from not eating much to eating. My body was holding and storing all that extra fat, or as much food as it could, because I'd constantly like starved my body. I was about 12 years old when I started to starve myself. I was 18 whenever I got pregnant, so that's quite a few years of, you know, doing that to my body. It seemed like he would throw that in my face every time. So that is red flag number one. I even cried right in front of him, but he had no remorse. He was just like, you know, you need to use a food journal. And he would make comments like, you've had to have had a cheeseburger today. And then he's like, well, I'm sure you've had a soda or something. He had no bedside manner, just literally joking about my weight. Scary to be 17 and 18 and pregnant. It's scary to be pregnant at any age, I think. I don't think you're ever really prepared. I had to limit what I ate. I did not keep a food journal like he asked me to because, you know, I was struggling in the beginning to even eat 3 meals a day, but just because of my eating disorder. The glucose appointment was really difficult for me because I did not have gestational diabetes, but that's when he wanted me to start my diet. And then after that, you know, I stopped looking at the scale and how much I weighed whenever I was 125 pounds. So red flag number one should have been how I was treated about my eating disorder. And red flag number two would be, I think, my birth plan. I went to Lamaze once and I got a birth plan and I felt like a real adult because I was like 18. I just wrote out something that I thought would be a magical experience that I was really excited and proud of. And I gave it to my obstetrician and he smiles at me. And as he smiles, he balls up my birth plan and throws it in the trash. And he says, you won't be needing this. So that is a huge red flag number two. I was afraid to switch care providers at 30 weeks. So I continued to see him and I was terrified for my birth because of that. I was already terrified to give birth. Like, how is it gonna go if I can't even plan out, you know, who I want in the room? I didn't know how to be an advocate for myself. I didn't know what anything was when I was 18, but it's still not my fault, and I struggle with that a lot. Finally, it's New Year's Eve. It's 7 a.m. I wake up with period cramps, and it's not my period. I'm like, this has to be labor. I call my obstetrician. They tell me to come in. They check me. I'm like 1 centimeter dilated, and he's like, you're not in labor. If you're a birth nerd like me, now you know that your cervix is not a crystal ball. He told me that I wasn't experiencing labor and not to try and be admitted because he would not admit me. I labored for 14 hours at home all day long. So I went to Walmart, got snacks, walked, because I knew as much as that would help me progress. So So I walked around Walmart Supercenter. I would have to stop at this point, have a contraction, and carry on with what I was doing. So I'm already progressing, I'm already not wanting food, and in the back of my mind, I'm like, I can't go to the hospital. I won't be admitted. So I did what my body told me to do. So I cleaned nonstop all day at home. I rested as much as I could. I just went with the day. But in my head and my mind, I was freaking out. I was like, I can't go to the hospital. You know, what am I gonna do? Where am I gonna have this baby? So I didn't wanna try and be admitted. I remember my dad frantically calling labor and delivery, like, my daughter's in labor and the obstetrician says she's not. I had no appetite and everything was progressing as it should. And I was terrified. Everything was unfolding just as it was supposed to. But I didn't know that. 8 to 10 p.m. I tried to be admitted for the first time. And they checked me, sent me home. Second time, checked me, sent me home. Third time, finally they admitted me. I signed in. I remember how embarrassing it was signing in. I would scream, and I'm a screamer too. You know, birth is different for everyone. Some of us scream. Finally, they wheel me up to my room. They check me. Like, I didn't want to be checked at all. I was uncomfortable with it because I've dealt with sexual assault. And I didn't know anything about your cervix not being a crystal ball then. I just didn't want to be touched unnecessarily by strangers. I was really uncomfortable with that, and I felt violated every time it happened. It was really painful too. And I would beg them not to. I wouldn't have lost my mucus plug or bloody show at all, because it was following the cervical check that came out. And that scared me to death. I didn't know what that was. I didn't learn about it. I wasn't in Lamaze long enough to learn these things, and I was terrified to do research, which I regret, because knowledge is power. Flag number two, birth plan. Red flag number three, them not wanting to admit me per doctor's orders. So red flag number four has to do with doctor's orders. Whenever I would cry and say no, the nurse that night would say, it's doctor's orders, so I guess it's like protocol. But still, like, we have to treat birthing people like human beings. If someone says no, I do not consent, you do not touch them. That's how we should treat human beings. But that's not how I was treated. Fortunately, that's not how a lot of people are treated when they're giving birth. Things started to pick up and intensify even more. They immediately gave me Pitocin. I knew that I didn't want it. And then it made contractions worse and harder and more intense. Everything was happening without my consent. Everything that I didn't want to happen was happening. And this is where the cascade of interventions comes in. Mom comes in, birth is progressing, and this is how the cascade of interventions works. One thing happens after another, because they introduce one thing, you're gonna get to this point. So that's what was happening to me. I did not end up with a belly birth. But I did end up with an epidural that I did not want. I remember they put some kind of medicine in my IV. I didn't want medicine at all. And I remember this panicky feeling of being drugged. It brought back triggering thoughts of my sexual assault. I panicked until I instantly fell asleep because the pain medicine, I guess, is what they gave me. I have no idea. Woke up needing my cervix checked again. Finally, that night turned into the next day. And I'm nearing that 31-hour mark where it's time for my baby to enter the world. Here is where I'm giving birth. I get my epidural at 30 hours in labor. Or maybe 20 minutes after the epidural, it's starting to work. I feel my body opening up. I feel like I have to poop. I feel like I have to pee. I feel like everything's opening. So I was like, I think I need to push. You know, I was going with what I was feeling, and I told the nurses that, and they're like, no, 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 wait for the doctor. You know, how can you hold your baby in and wait for the doctor? I'm not waiting for anyone. He comes in, I'm ready to push, and didn't give birth on the first push because he was counting. That's not how it works. Birth doesn't go how your care provider wants it. It wasn't going as fast as he wanted, I guess. And he was like, you're not doing it right. You can't do this, just stop. He hadn't been there the whole 31 hours of my labor, just nurses and my family had been. He just gets there and he's telling me that I can't do this and I'm not doing it right and to stop. So he leaves the room for maybe 5 minutes, push for 15 minutes total. He was there for maybe a minute and then left for 5 minutes. He comes in just in time to give me an unnecessary episiotomy. Cut me down to my butt, and I had 22 stitches, and he told me that. He didn't ask, he just did it. He grabbed the scissors and did it. He rushed that baby out. So we did the episiotomy, and he said, "You have 22 stitches now." And my baby was placed on my chest for a second, and then she was taken off my chest and passed around the room. She was bathed of her vernal, which I wanted rubbed in. Her cord was clipped immediately. It still has a lot of blood going through it that she didn't get. And if they read my birth plan, they would have known. That's one of the red flags too. You know, there's nothing that I could have done at that point, but I wish, like, postpartum, I could have looked back to all this and be like, oh, it's starting to make sense. I have postpartum depression and anxiety. I have PTSD, but I didn't. They didn't give me my baby, and I didn't get to nurse until about an hour and a half. Didn't get to do skin to skin, no delayed cord clamping, no immediate breastfeeding. It wasn't the natural birth that I wanted or asked for, and you shouldn't have to ask for it. Your birth should be birth. The next red flags would be postpartum. I get in the wheelchair to be wheeled out to the car to leave the hospital, and I'm having like detachment issues with my baby. You know, from the moment she was finally given to me to nurse, I was thinking in my head, what do I do with this baby? So I get home and I'm dizzy. I can't eat. I have no appetite. All I can do is cry. Google it and it's like baby blues. And I think, okay, so that's what I have. A few months pass. I still have detachment issues with my baby. Like, who is this baby? It's hard for me to hold her and be close to her. It's hard for me to let her nurse. I felt like this was crazy. Like, I'm not supposed to feel this way. I'm supposed to be a mom, and I'm supposed to be a good mom, and I'm supposed to keep it together for my baby. But I wasn't. I was breaking more and more every day. Finally, at a year and a half postpartum, I'm going to the doctor to be checked for my stomach. Finally seeing the red flags, I'm thinking, okay, so I didn't want to hold my baby all of these times that I've held her and kept her close. I didn't want to nurse her, but I did anyways. I didn't want anything to do with my baby this whole time, but I still cared for her. And I dealt with these stomach problems that, you know, we couldn't figure out what it was. It wasn't gallstones. We did blood work. We did a stool test. It wasn't any of these things. No one asks you how you're feeling after you have a baby. Noticed at the pediatrician that they give you these little questionnaires, but that's a joke. So no one asked me how I was feeling, and everything started to add up. So I realized maybe it's not my stomach. Maybe it's my anxiety. Maybe I'm making my stomach messed up. Maybe I'm the reason why I'm going to the bathroom 20 plus times a day. I kept that to myself. I think I told my mom, you know, I think maybe I've been struggling with postpartum depression, but we didn't do anything about it. So finally, my daughter is 3 years old. I get involved with this program called FIP. It's a family infant program. And I got involved in it for my family, not so much for me, but it came along with a therapist. Thankful for my therapist and for being introduced to FIP, because I don't think that I would have made it through another pregnancy. I don't think that I would have made it through another birth. I don't think that I would have made it this far with a second child if I had not gotten help. And I think that it's really hard to reach out to other people when you're going through something. People say that you can get over it, but you can't. You know, it takes work. It takes therapy. So help looks different for everyone, but I can't stress enough how important it is to find someone safe and non-judgmental to help you get the help that you need and the help that you deserve. I wouldn't be the mom that I am today if I didn't get help. Postpartum was much different with my second child than my first. I didn't go home with trauma and abuse. I was already at home and I was respected in my own home. You know, my midwife asked, is this okay? Is it okay if I do this? It wasn't like, this is what we're gonna do to you and you better listen. Leave your dignity at the door. It wasn't like that with my home birth. It was more like, what can I do to make you feel most comfortable? This video is actually really hard for me to do, but thank you for listening, and I hope this video helps some people. I really do.